this antelope, we boiled the sheaths off, we removed all the meat and tendons from off the horns, the skull plate, cleaned out the inside of the cavity of the horn, the horns. We're gonna make sure they fit back on the skull plate the way they should. Everything fits. At this point, we lay them aside. We've let these dry for a couple weeks before we're gonna glue them back on, just to make sure we get a good adhesion to it. These fit good. Occasionally, you'll have a pair that won't go down on good for some reason or other. You may have to cut a little bit of this off or grind it to get your horns to set. When this is done, if you paid attention when you skinned it, you'll have probably about a quarter to 3/8 of an inch above the eye to the base of the horn, and that's where you want to set your horn. We're going to use Bondo to Bondo these on this morning. We'll mix up a batch of Bondo. We want to make sure we've got plenty to do this project. As I said, I waste a lot of Bondo over the years by mixing too much, but when I'm in the middle of something, throwing a little away a whole lot better than running short and not getting the job done correct. Just mix this up at a, oh, you can adjust the rate the way you want. After you play with Bondo long enough, you'll know how much hardener it takes to set it up at a certain speed. This is not a real big deal that has to set up fast or anything, so I just got a medium set time here. It'll probably take 5 to 7 minutes, but I'm going to put a fairly good coat on the inner sheath, and I'll just take some and I'm going to put a little bit inside the sheath too. When I push this down on, I want to make sure I get the adhesion and get good connection all over on this deal. But I'll take this horn and rather than push straight, you know, you just push this horn on, carefully pushing it on, twist it a little bit if you need to, push it down to the height you want it to set on. Right now I got enough Bondo in there to hold it good where I want it. Now the rest of that Bondo at the base there, I'm just going to let that for the most part set up. I'll take it off with a wire brush just as it's gelling. We'll repeat that same step with the opposite side. As you can see, I've got plenty of Bondo here. As again, I mixed up too much, but if I was doing a lot of these or doing my whole set for the year for my horn panels, you know, this one here is going to be a horn panel, but basically a horn panel, European head mount. These sheaths all go on the same. When you're doing a European, you have to be a little more careful so you don't get the Bondo on the skull, because the skull has been cleaned and it's going to stay just the skull, or this skull or for a head mount or a horn panel is going to get covered. Here again, we just slowly work it down, letting the excess Bondo push out, carefully push it down to the height we want. Set that aside, keeping a watch on it, so when it starts to gel, we're ready to take it off with a brush or whatever tool we need, screwdriver, one of my modeling tools, most anything. This Bondo is basically wasted because I got no other projects going right now to use it. But we're just gonna let that set aside right now until it starts to gel, and then we'll take it off. Okay, at this time the Bondo is gelled up. It's probably been about 5 minutes, 6 minutes. We're just gonna scrape off the gel. You can see how nice it comes off right now. If you let it get too hard, it'll be really hard to get off. You get it at the right point, being careful not to pull on the horns, because in this step, you can also pull them horns off. Right now is the most vulnerable time with that Bondo being movable. So now this set of horns happens to be for a head mount. So we've got the Bondo cleaned off, and it can be put away and ready for either head mount or a European or a horn panel at this time. Okay, with our horns prepared for mounting, today we're going to do a horn panel with this set of horns. We've taken this, we've completely cut off the front to make it look, because our mache is only going to come up so far. We squared the back. When we square the back, I lay it in my vise and I draw an angle of what I want this to go to the wall. You know, I want this to set up the wall. I don't want it laying out from a wall like this. I want it setting up against the wall. So I get my angle figured out. My saws all that off. You can take it to the grinder to help do that if you need to. Then after that's done, since these horns are so thin, at this point we hadn't filled this with kitty hair yet because we would have ruined too much kitty hair. So once we got our trimming done and we filled this with kitty hair, we let it set up. Next step we'll do, you need to take it to the grinder or use a wire cutters, but we'll cut these eye sockets off so that we don't. In fact, I'm going to take it to the grinder. I'm going to grind these off so they're down even with the horns. Now you can see what I've ground off. The reason I did that is I don't want that. I don't want to have to build my paper mache in my circle all the way out past that edge. So I grind that off so I can keep. I don't like my size of my plate to be any bigger than it has to be. Now I use a round plate on antelope. I use a round plate on deer. When it comes to elk, I'll use a round. And then I'll drop down, I'll make kind of a teardrop out of it with another round at the bottom, and then connect them and make, you can make this any shape you want. These are just the shapes I've used over the years. We're going to use a compass at this time to get our circle. We're going to lay this compass out, and this will all take practice over time so you don't get it too big, too small. But I'm kind of going right to the edge of the horn, where I know I can build up to on both sides, and that's going to be the size of the circle I'm going to start with. I'm going to draw it out. Now I like to use a 3/4 inch piece of particle board. And here again, this is all going to take time and practice. Over time you're going to learn how big you want this piece. I got my circle drawn on my 3/4 inch particle board. I'm gonna lay my horns up on it and make sure that I can get. Now the horns aren't gonna set right in the center. The horns are gonna go a little more to the top of the circle so that the horns are, I don't want as much paper mache up top as I want down below. But that size there will work. We're just gonna use our jigsaw. We're gonna cut that circle out. Started to stop. We're round. We didn't get any knobs. Make sure our circle's pretty well round. If there's any bad spots on it, we either put them behind the horn or we'll take them to the grinder and grind it. Sometimes it's hard with a jigsaw to cut all the way through them and make a good cut. This one turned out okay. My horn's going to fit on it nice. At this time, I use 3 screws to put this on. I'm gonna put 1 screw in the center towards the back. The thing I want to do is I don't want to go straight down like this. I don't want that screw coming out down here. I want it coming out back here. So I ran it at a slant to go with it. I'm gonna put 2 screws up in the front, 1 here, 1 here. Now since I had this cut right, I don't have to shim it. If customer brings it in cut off and it's cut off wrong, you may have to use some wood shims to hold it in place. At this point, I gotta get it set where I need it. That's, as I said, you know, I'll show you as soon as I get it screwed down in place. I can't pick it up right now or it'll move on me. It looks like I need about a 3-inch screw in this one. And a 3-inch screw went through it, came through the back a little bit. I'll take that to the grinder after I get all my screws in, grind it off. But as you can see, my horns are set up a little bit closer to the top than they are to the bottom. So I don't want my horns down in my paper mache. When I'm done filling this paper mache, I'll show you. My horns are above my paper mache, but right now I've got it centered. I'll eye it, I'll get it centered where it looks like it's even for me. I'll drive my last 2 screws in. Making sure things don't move on me. I keep all different lengths of screws on hand for these projects. I just put 2 3-inch ones in, and this back one's only gonna take 1 5/8". There, I've got all my screws set, my horns are good and tight. My next step, I'm gonna take this to the grinder, I'm gonna grind them screws off that came all the way through the wood so I don't cut something. The other thing is, I don't wanna scratch the panel when I go to put this on the panel, so doing that at this point, could save me a lot of grief later if I forgot to do it. Now I'm just going to take some regular set paper mache. I'm going to mix up some regular set paper mache to the consistency I like to work with. You'll learn your consistency. Now when you put this mache on, you want to keep your water handy so that you can smooth the mache down with it. Try to keep from touching the horns with the, I try to keep mache on one hand only so I can grab the horns with my other hand. I don't like to get too much mache on the horns as it makes it just harder to clean it up. I always keep my container of water sitting here. I'll use that to pat things in place, but you can see the consistency I like now. It'll break apart, it'll stick together good. Keep that one hand clean. Just start pushing this into place on this form, forming it up. Making sure everything's in tight. One batch of mache ain't gonna do it. Going to get me 75% done, but I'm going to need a little more. One thing about mache is it takes a while to set up, so you can, sometimes when I do an elk, I got to mix 3 different batches or remove some of my bigger animals. You know, but I'll get my hands wet, just kind of push that, make sure that that mache is pushed all the way down in there. I'm going to mix up a little bit more. This should be enough to finish it. This top coat I got, I'm probably going to use it a little bit sloppier than I did the first one, the first one sets underneath. I don't want it to sag once you get it thinner. Now I've done elk where I've had to put the first layer on, and since they're such a big animal, I've had to let it be and then put the last quarter to half inch on once that first layer is set up. Otherwise it just sags too much and causes too much sanding at a later time. The neater job you do with this, the less you have to file and sand later, the more time you're going to save, because that filing, sanding this paper mache when it gets hard is time consuming. So I do this step fairly carefully and I try to get exactly what I want. I don't want it bigger than my board at the bottom, but you can get an idea. What I'm doing, I'm just slowly sloping up towards the horns, adding paper mache where I need it to try to get it even from side to side. I'm watching carefully what I do here. Trying to keep it as smooth as possible by keeping my hands wet, keeping a rag handy. Right now I'm just feathering it out towards the board from the horns out. Now, for later steps, when you put your leather or your covering on, you need somewhere to tuck that covering, so I take it modeling tool of some type. You could use a screwdriver blade if you needed to, and I just basically pull this away from the edge of that horn about a quarter inch, and that quarter inch will be filled in with clay at a later time when it comes time to put our covering on it, whether we use leather or whatever. Now you may have excess here you have to get off. Repeat that step on the opposite side. Like I said, anytime you take that down, you may have excess stuff that you got to scrape off and get rid of. Now this paper mache won't cure out for, well, it depends on the temperature, but 2 to 3 days. You want it to turn good and white. You don't want it to have any damp looking color to it when you go to put, especially if you're using leather, because it'll stain your leather through it, and then you'll have a ruined piece of leather. And leather, today's price of leather is too expensive to ruin, and your time's too expensive to do. So don't figure you're gonna start a horn panel and finish it the same day. Once I get this step done, I'm gonna lay it aside, and it might be 2 weeks before I grab this thing again. It might be 3 days. 3 days it should be okay, but a lot of times I'll set them all up like this when I get them in, and then I'll take 1 day and start covering them and finishing them at a later time. But there, I've carefully worked it all the way to the board. I've got a fairly smooth finish. It ain't gonna take, shouldn't take much sanding or file work to get that down. I got my shape I want. I got the hump fairly even in the middle, so when I get my leather on, it looks like I'm even all the way back. And like I said, at this point, we're just gonna lay this aside somewhere other so we can keep working and let it set up. But that's what the first step of your horn panel is gonna look like. We'll let it dry and finish it later. Okay, the paper mache on this horn panel is set up dry enough. And dry enough, we're gonna file it smooth. Now, if your previous step was done right, this doesn't take too long. If you didn't left it really rough or uneven, you can can spend more time doing this than it would be to knock it off and start over. In the past, when I've trained people, I've had people working for me, trained them to do horn panels. It never fails. We've had to knock quite a few off and start over putting the paper mache on because it wasn't even enough and wasn't straight enough for a customer's mount. You know, you want to make sure it's even from side to side, not too rough. You don't want to spend an hour sanding something that takes another 15 minutes to rebuild. So it's just best to learn properly, get it even when you're doing it originally, because it takes a long time to straighten out with a file. This stuff files pretty hard. Right now all I'm doing is smoothing it out so I can now I'm gonna go use a damp rag and wipe that so it's damp. Get that dust off, otherwise that dust is gonna get on my leather. I'm just gonna use it. It ain't a very damp rag. It's got just a hair of moisture. I don't want any real moisture on it. I just want something to pick that dust up. Because I wanna felt this right away. Now if you wanna sand it down, wash it off, lay it aside, then you can use more of a damp rag. But now I'm gonna use a wire brush and get all the borax or all the paper mache and any dirt and stuff we've gotten on the horns and around the horn bases. Clean them up at this time because once the leather's on, you don't want to be cleaning a whole lot. You are going to see that I'm going to put the leather on before I oil these horns though. And the reason I do that is because it seems like we originally started out, we put the oil on, oil the horns, and then put the leather on. We always ended up touching the leather with our oil, the hands. We'd touch the horns and end up touching the leather and causing problems. Once that leather stains, it doesn't clean up. Now I've got that ready to put the leather on. I always lay a clean towel out so that I don't get dirt on my leather. I'm gonna take a thin, probably 1/4 inch line of caulk, and I'm gonna go around where we originally raked that paper mache away from them horns and made that little indentation under the horns where I said I'm gonna tuck my leather. I'm gonna fill that in with caulk and just feather it out a little bit over the paper mache so it blends in as I'm putting leather on. This way I can push the leather into the clay. When that clay dries, it'll hold that leather in place real well. Because there's no glues or anything go on a horn panel. Always keep a rag handy and wipe that caulk off, because that caulk will stain the leather too. Now when I'm dealing with leather, I use two colors. I use a dark brown and a cream. Just find two colors that are accessible to you that you like. One's a lighter color, one's a darker color. The cream's a, I'll show you a piece of cream. Here's the cream color we use. Now over the years I've gone to using the suede side on my horn panel, and then I'll use the finished side of the leather on the braid that I put around it. But I make sure I got a nice piece that'll hasn't got it too much for blemish in it, and then I'll just pull it up. Make sure it's going to be a big enough piece to completely cover your panel. And I always start by putting two or three staples right in this top back piece that I pull through. That's my starting point, and I'll just take my scalpel, I'll cut that off. You always want a newer, keep a new pair of scissors, a good pair of scissors on hand to trim this leather. Now I don't over pull it, I don't overstretch it, but you want it tight around there. So I'm going to pull the center down, and I'm going to put a couple staples in the bottom here. Now I'm going to start working around the sides, and I'm putting a little pressure, but I'm not overstretching this leather. I've got that side somewhat in place. Now I'm going to pull this leather around. As you can see, I'm starting here towards the top, then working my wrinkles out and going back towards them staples I put in on the bottom. And now that I got that leather somewhat in place, I'm going to get rid of my excess leather. I like to use a good scalpel blade when I'm doing this. Got rid of the old one. Just trim inside your staples. You'll learn where to make these cuts so you don't waste any more leather than you have to. Leather is expensive. You can use felt for this process. You can use felt while you're learning if you're just going to practice on some of your own. You know, felt's cheaper. When I learned taxidermy, that's what the gentleman I worked for was using was felt. When I started the business, I decided I didn't want that cheap looking felt. Most of it was green or red felt and it was just kind of cheap looking. So I upped it to leather, and that's where I'm at today, 29 years later. I use a little fine screwdriver. You can just anything to poke this, but now that you got this somewhat pulled into place and stapled 3/4 of the way up the side on both sides, you're gonna take your scissors, you're carefully gonna start working down towards the base of that horn. You don't wanna make cut too far in, but get it so it lays flat around there. And then just start trimming. The hardest part's holding it and cutting at the same time. Especially antelope. Deer seem to rest on the horn for you when you're doing a deer one. But you're just going to have to get a feel of how much you're going to trim off, so that you got some to tuck down there, because you want to push some down that clay. A little mistake is no big deal, because you're going to put a piece of braid around it anyway. I like it to tuck pretty close to that horn. Once I push it in there, I'll just use my thumb and push the clay back up to the edge and lock it in place. About 2 more inches, and I'll just cut a little ways, and then I'll work it around, coming around. I don't just cut it all at one time, because if something's a little out of place, you need a little to work with. See, I'm pushing that clay back up and locking it into place. We're just about around to this back here. Now we want to make sure our seam is on the back of the horn, but we got to make sure it covers this piece down here. So we find that piece and we go right down that deal, and we got enough there to cover. It overlaps a little. We'll hot glue that in place. When we go to hot glue our braid on, we'll just push that down, lock it in place. Pull this snug, put a couple more staples in. There, we got one side done. We're gonna turn around. We're gonna repeat that process on the other side. Same exact way. Cut down the center of that horn to get yourself a starting point. Once you get down, then you can trim it. As I said, this is practice. Everything we're teaching you, none of it comes automatic. It all takes practice. None of it's hard. As long as you practice and listen to the steps. Watch these videos, go out and try some. Figure out where you're having your problems. Come back and watch the videos and pay attention to that part of the video where you're having the most problem. I believe that's going to be the nice thing about this website is you can keep coming right back to these spots. Watch these videos. Go out. If things work right, we can keep these videos at a cheap enough cost that you should be able to, well, if you were going to go to school, you'd be spending anywhere from $4,000 to $7,000 for 7 to 9 weeks. Here you can spend a whole year for 12 times what our monthly rate's going to be. And, you know, that's, we don't know, I can't tell you what the monthly rate's going to be at the time you're watching this. I know our introductory offer, we're talking $65 a month. Well, if it stays at $65 a month, if we can make it work at that, you'll be able to spend a whole year for $780. You can watch 12 months worth of videos for probably 20 cents on the dollar to what a school would be. And you can keep going back them videos. Now school, yep, you got hands on, you got someone standing there watching you, telling you what you're doing wrong, right up until that 7 weeks is up and you walk out of there and then it's done. Then you're expected to remember it, and studies have showed we retain less than 20% of what we learn. We have to relearn the other 80%, where these videos are just something you can go back to help relearn it. There, at this time we've got all that covered. Plug our glue gun in, let that heat up. We're gonna lay this right aside now. I'm gonna show you how I make my braid. Now I'm gonna cheat a little today. When I cut my braid, I usually cut a complete, in fact, I got enough braid already braided up to do this one, but I will show you how I do my braid. When I cut my braid, I lay a whole sheet of leather out. I go through enough braid that I lay the whole sheet out. And on a nice smooth board, and I take my scalpel and cut that whole hide up in the braid and put it in a bag. So when I do it, I got 4 or 5 years worth of braid all cut at one time. All I have to do is braid it together. I don't sit and braid it all at one time, but braiding's easy. We'll show you how to braid here for a little bit, but Braiding's a pretty simple. Pretty simple deal. I just lay my three braids out. I always leave them connected at the top, or you can tape them together, whatever, but I tack that down on a board or table. I always do it on my table. And basically, you just take an outside one, you go over the center. Always keep them away, always keeping them pulled somewhat snug. Don't over tighten them, but keep them so the same side is up all the time, and just keep taking the opposite outside one over the center one. But we just do this step and keep repeating it. It'll take 5-7 minutes to do this whole braid all the way down once I get going. And then I'll just tape it off at the bottom. Once I get down to the edge of my table, I'll slide the nail out and go all the way up rather than cut my braid. I like to do them in long pieces. That way I got what I need, but we'll just finish braiding this and then we'll put it on the horn panel. Step we're gonna do now with this antelope is I like to color these horns back a little. So I'm gonna hold this antelope upside down and lightly put used engine oil. I'll start at the base and let it go towards the tip. But I don't want this oil on the leather because it'll stain it. So I just carefully work my way around the base. Now some of you will ask why I didn't do this before I put the leather on, because then we grab these horns and pick up a residue and touch the leather. So just lightly brush that on. It'll give it some luster and some life back to them horns. I keep an old shop rag handy. Once I get one side done, I'll just use a shop rag to grab that side. I'll paint the other side, do the same steps. Careful up around the base. As it runs down, it'll use the engine oil. I use that on a lot of my African stuff, a lot of my antelope, anything that's got a black sheath to it. It brings it back to life. Now you don't want to leave it on there real thick. I get it painted on like that, put a layer on, and then just take that old shop towel and take it back off, rub it good, get off what you can. Put it on, take it off, put it on, take it off. That just gives your horns their appeal back to them. Then we'll lay our towel back out that we use when we put the leather on. Next step is going to be this braid we made. We're going to put that on. Since we used the suede side doing the panel, we're going to use the smooth finish side of the braid, putting it on. We'll do that with a hot glue gun. First thing is we're going to hot glue these seams down with just a little bit to make sure that they don't let loose. Just one little spot, being careful to make sure it's under and not out where it's gonna show, because it doesn't come out of the leather very good. That'll keep that seam from ever opening up. Now we're just gonna start with a light right on the back side of the horn, right at the beginning of the seam. You can go right next to the horn, about a fourth of the way around, and we'll just lay this braid so it's up on the horn, maybe a 16th of an inch, but the most of it's gonna be on the leather. Basically, we're trying to hide that seam between the horn and the leather and give it a finished look with this braid. Now, I've seen it done with rope, I've seen it done with a lot of stuff. I think braid, since we're using leather to begin with, the braid just looks more professional. Bring it back, we'll just overlap it a little back here. Take our scissors, cut it off. We'll repeat the same step on the other side. Doesn't take much glue, just a thin line of glue to lay that braid in, and it'll never go anywhere. Cut that off, take my glue gun right where my three pieces come together, I put a little shot of glue there. Lay that piece aside, next time I need a piece of braid, I'll still have that piece to work with. That should do, almost do one more hole in a little poor deer panel. Now I'm lightly gonna work anything that's on that leather off. I got a few pieces of hair on there, the way it looks from the shop. I didn't get any glue on it, that's gotta come off. Sometimes if you get a little glue, you gotta trim it off with a sharp scalpel really carefully, so you don't wreck your leather. You wreck your leather at this point, you gotta start over. Next step's gonna be connecting this to the panel. I've gone to using my Mackenzie hangers. I don't like them on my head mounts, but I use them on my horn panels and stuff. I got a different hanger system on my head mounts, but I'll just mount that hanger, center that hanger, and make sure you're using 3/4 inch screws. Them look like they're longer. You don't want to go through these panels. Now, when I lay my horns on my panel, I don't want my horns in the center. I like my horns a little more to the top, so I'm going to figure out about where I need to pilot a couple holes in. So I'm behind there, I'll just... put a couple holes in. I don't go straight up and down, I move them down a little. Go to the side a little, make sure they're about an inch and a half, 2 inches apart, somewhere around there. Drill them from that side to the back side. I just countersink so my heads go. I just use a bigger bit. Very carefully putting a countersink in it. These staples didn't go in tight in the back. I don't want to scratch my panel. It's moving around and scratching. I'm just going to tap them down. Put my panel on. Try to center it where I want it so I got the right shape. I usually put my palm on my handle and I'll flip this right over. Let that hang on there and I'll take the first 2-inch screw. Tighten that in. Make sure it's where I want it yet. I'll hold it up to the wall. Make sure it looks good. Looks like it's square. I usually try to line these horns up so they're pretty much even on the ears of my panel. I've got this one set where I want it. Tighten them 2 screws in. That horn panel's ready to go to the customer. Make sure there's no dirt or something on it, no blemishes. Panel's all good. I've got a finished antelope horn panel for the customer.